Welcome to the Stronger for Business podcast with Diffrig Jenkins, Pete Rushmer, and myself, Bev Thorogood. Stronger for Business is a training consortium dedicated to bringing high-quality training solutions to businesses through the combined expertise of our partners. From skills training to developing personal and professional excellence, our mission is to help business owners get the very best from their people at all levels, from boardroom to shop floor. The Stronger for Business podcast is our opportunity to share our knowledge, thoughts and ideas with you, the listener. You'll get to meet some awesome guests from across the business world, sharing their experience of learning and development. If you love what we have to say, make sure you hit the subscribe button on whatever platform you use to consume your podcasts so you don't miss out on future episodes. We'd love to hear from you with your suggestions for discussion topics or ideas for future guests. And if you really love what you hear, please do consider leaving us a 5-star review, as this helps to get the podcast out to a wider audience. Sit back and enjoy the Stronger for Business podcast.
Hi everyone, thanks for joining us. I always feel a huge amount of pressure when I have to host the Stronger for Business podcast. Bev does such a good job when she's here. Welcome everyone. You'll notice there's Dove, and I'd like to introduce you to Matthew O'Day from Cleveland, Ohio. Thanks for joining us, Matt.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me, Pete. I appreciate it.
Awesome. We're really looking forward to speaking to you shortly. Today's podcast is going to be around adversity, facing adversity, and how we can overcome that with a really positive mindset, how we can work on our mindset, and tips for people. Matt's been through a whole range of challenges, which hopefully he's going to share quite openly with us today and talk about. And he's got a fantastic mindset. He's a motivational speaker, and I'm really, really excited to share him with you guys today so you guys can have some insight into his life and his mindset as well, because it's really, really inspirational. With regards to Bev, unfortunately, she can't be with us today. She's busy getting a tattoo of Little Mix somewhere. No, I don't know. But yeah, sadly, she can't be with us. So yeah, we'll get cracking straight onto it, Dove, shall we?
Yeah, let's do that. I'd like to extend my thanks to Matt as well. Matt got in touch with me. It seems like ages ago now. I think it's probably about 2 months ago, to see if he could jump onto one of the sessions that I was running. It wasn't the right format, because there's no way that Matt could have got all his story across in that amount of time. So you've kindly agreed to jump on the podcast. So it's yes, a pleasure to have you here. Thank you.
Yeah, 100%, absolute pleasure. So Matt, we've told the listeners a little bit about you, but go on, if you could just sort of explain a bit more about some of the stuff that's been going on and how you manage that.
Absolutely. So as you said, I'm from Cleveland, Ohio. I am currently 28 years old. I'll give you the quick version, then we'll go more in depth with everything. But 4 years ago, I was diagnosed with stage 3C testicular cancer. At the time, I was a personal trainer, working out all the time, eating healthy. And one day I started puking up blood, and I got rushed to the emergency room. They did a bunch of tests on me, and they ended up finding out that I had an 11-centimeter tumor in my small intestine. So that's when I got rushed to the Cleveland Clinic, which is one of the top hospitals in the United States. Thank God, I was so close to it. And, immediately from there, that's where they found out I had cancer, and I was put on chemotherapy. After chemotherapy, I had many near-death experiences, from being in a coma to being in the ICU for over 40 days, dropping from 185-pound personal trainer to 110 pounds in a matter of, only months. Having to learn to completely walk again. I had 5 surgeries in less than 30 days. I had kidney and liver failure and many, many more complications. And, today it's not about necessarily just my story that I want to share with you guys, but it's about overcoming adversity in your life and using it as a lesson instead of an excuse to not just be a better version of yourself, but to impact other people who need to hear your message and your story as well.
What a great summary.
Literally, I'm speechless. It's so difficult, isn't it? Like, had for such a short time, you've had so much happen to you, haven't you? So just to give the listeners an idea, you're 28 now. This wasn't that long ago, was it?
No, so 24, and I always start, so when I, so I'm also a keynote motivational speaker now, I'm, and in addition, I'm also a coach for other individuals, not just cancer survivors, but individuals who've gone through challenging experiences in their life, mentally and physically, and I'm helping them regain control of their life and all of the, you know, setbacks that they've gone through, and helping them to, you know, become that better version of themselves. But when I talk about my speech, I always start with a specific date, and that was 4 years ago, on March 17th of 2016, and that was actually the day that I met my girlfriend. And, you know, it was St. Patrick's Day, which I don't know if you guys celebrate St. Patrick's Day in the UK or not. Yes.
100%. And it's also my daughter's birthday as well. My youngest daughter was born on March 17th. Yeah.
This is meant to be then. I love it. You know, yes, so extremely special day too for me. So obviously it's a special day for you as well. And, you know, having a couple of drinks, I met her at a bar, but it's really about, you know, how we grew together throughout this entire journey. Because when I was diagnosed with cancer, which was only 3 months later, we'd only been dating for 2 months at that time. And, you know, at the time I was like, you know, I don't know if she's going to stay with me. You know, this is a huge burden to put on, you know, somebody who's only been dating you for 2 months. And she basically, the second she found out, she came rushing over to the hospital and she's like, listen, Matt, no matter what you're going through, I will be here for you every step of the way. And honestly, instantly, like right like that, my mindset shifted. My mindset changed. I was able to go from this scared and, you know, how am I going to get through this like mindset to, I have somebody in my life. I had my parents as well, which they're absolutely incredible. And I had friends too, but to have that like one person that like you really need to rely on, having her in my life was a vital key of this journey. And I'll explain more why. So, but yeah, I was diagnosed, as you were saying, at 24 years old. So it's only been not even 4 years since I was diagnosed. So really I'm technically only 3 years cancer free.
Got you. I think it's incredible for you to have had such an inspiring journey from the back of that, and I think it's wonderful, certainly at such a young age as well, that your partner's been there and been so supportive as well for you, and actually that makes such a difference as well when we look at adversity and having a good solid relationship. Fantastic. So with regards to obviously that was a horrific situation that came through, sort of explain a bit more about sort of the really challenging times and where your mindset might have gone. Have you always been as positive about it, or have you actually you know, did it get quite dark at times for you?
Very dark at times. Yeah, absolutely. So I want to say something really quick. So when I was diagnosed with cancer, you know, obviously I had that scarcity mindset, like right then and there I was like, you know, I wasn't focusing on how was I, you know, could I potentially die, but what I was saying was, how am I going to be strong for my parents, for Lauren, for all these people who need me? And I was putting this massive burden on myself. And, you know, as time went by and by and by, as I started going, so immediately after they found out that I had cancer, they put me on intense rounds of chemotherapy. They put me on what's called BEP, and it's bleomycin, etoposide, and cisplatin, which is very intense what I would just call drugs that, you know, destroy not just your good cells and your bad cells. And I had very, very rough days. And those days didn't just turn into physically rough days, but they turned into mentally challenging days as well. From, you know, not just losing my red hair, but like days where I couldn't even get out of bed, days where I, you know, couldn't even eat anything because I just was so nauseous. And I, to make matters worse, I would say this was one of the biggest mental hurdles throughout my chemotherapy, at least, was right in the middle of my chemotherapy, my 3-year-old puppy passed away from cancer. And I know it's like, you know, it's like, yeah, it's your puppy, but like for me, it was like my best friend, because honestly, I actually took him to all his chemo sessions about 6 months before I was even diagnosed. And we were fighting this together. And to have some, you know, to have like your best friend pass away was super, super challenging. And I started to go into this mindset of like, why is this all happening to me? Like, you know, making these excuses for everything in life, saying, you know, I don't want to go to chemotherapy. I don't want to get myself healthy. I don't want to do anything, because it's like, you know, for me, I'm faith-based and I'm not pushing faith on anybody. But for me, I was like, God, why are you constantly giving me setbacks? All I want to do is just progress forward. And little did I know, it was just going to make me stronger and stronger. But at the time, for probably about a week, I was just like, I would lay in my bed and not want to do anything. And then one day, I kind of woke up and I was just looking at the ceiling and I said, is this what Lauren, who was my girlfriend at the time, is this what my parents, is this what Duke, my puppy, or anybody would want me to do, just give up on myself? That's a question I want to ask some people. It's like, if you're in a difficult situation and you're just kind of giving up, think more than just yourself. Stop thinking about yourself. Stop being selfish and think about the other people who need you as well. And that's what I said. I said, absolutely not. Nobody wants me to give up on myself. So why would I give up on myself? So you know what I did? I did something little every single day, just one little thing that would progress me forward. That is how I got out of my mental and physical struggles throughout chemo, is saying, hey, listen, if I can just get up and I can go walk 100 meters today, perfectly fine. If I can go and eat something a little healthier today, perfectly fine. And it's the little things compounded each day is what allows you to break through those setbacks and those mental hurdles.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So I think your story there really, really resonates with me too. And listeners who have listened through our journey with the podcast as well will know that I've also faced similar challenges, probably not for such a sustained period of time as yourself, but life-threatening illnesses. And the thing is one of the things when that victim mindset hits, you start to identify with that. So when I got poorly, I was only sort of 17, 18, and it's much further away in my life than what it is for you. And it's taken me, I fully respect the journey you've been on, because it took me so much longer to get my mindset right around it. And I had really, really dark periods of time for a long period. And the thing is, you identify with that, particularly, I don't know how women understand it, but from a man point of view or a young man point of view, I identified with being a healthy male. And then all of a sudden that identity changes because you're not healthy anymore. You're a poorly person. And it's like, is that what I am now? Am I a poorly person? And you have this victim mindset that sort of builds up. And actually, one of the things that happened to me and why I resonate so much is when I was in the hospital bed, I was still in intensive care, but I was starting to get better. I'd come out of the coma. And I'm not sure whether they're a famous band in America, but a band called The M People. In the UK, there's a band called The M People, and the song is called "What Have You Done Today to Make Yourself Feel Proud?" And that was a song which came on whilst I sat in the bed. I couldn't move, I couldn't talk or anything. And actually, that was a real turning point for me. Was actually, do you know what? I can take back control of this. I can make myself better again, and I can still control the person I am in my head. And that was kind of the ethos I lived by too. Was just a step at a time. Each time I could just build my own self-esteem back up as well.
Yeah, it's incredible. And you know what's helped me is I have a little saying that I always tell myself, and whenever I hit adversity, I say, either you can either go one or two ways. You could say, why is this happening to me, like I told you before, or how is this happening for me? Just like you were saying, you were going through all these challenges and you needed to make a change. If you start looking at life as, how is this happening for me, it lets you look at life and your adversity and your challenges as a lesson, as a tool to better yourself. And what that does is not just better yourself, but better other people around you as well. You know, your greatest success in life is not going to come from your wins. It's not going to come from your success. It's going to come from all the failures, all the setbacks, all the adversity in your life. So you need to start looking at all the most difficult moments of your life as an actual blessing and actually something that is vital to your key to figuring out who you're meant to be in your life. So, you know, and everybody has their own timeline of figuring that out, because, you know, a lot of people take longer to heal than others. And some people take a shorter time to heal. I think it's a lot, like you were saying before, starts in the mind. And when you're ready to take control of that mind, that's when you're ready to take control of your life. You know, everything starts with the mind before anything else. So that's kind of my little motto, is everything happens for me, not to me.
Yeah, that's a great outlook to have. What'd you say, Duff? I'm going to let you in now. Matt and I have just been like to and fro in there, so sorry.
Well, I can't relate to the experiences that you guys have had, so I'm not going to even pretend to go anywhere near that, because it's pointless. And yeah, that would be embarrassing to even to try to pretend. But it's really interesting, actually. You know, obviously, you know, we're talking about life changing. Health perspectives, but the first conversation I had with Matt, you shared that, you know, why is this happening to me, but why is this happening for me? And I thought that was such a powerful, you know, it's only just a couple of words, isn't it? But that was so powerful. And actually, a couple of weeks ago, and we all know, for those of us that own businesses or work in businesses or organizations, that, you know, the last 3 months have been really, really difficult. And you know, and we've all had peaks and troughs. because, everybody's reality is their reality, isn't it? And it's as serious or not as serious as they believe that it is. And that's really important. And actually, a few weeks ago, I hit a bit of a wall. And actually, one of the first things, it wasn't my M People song that Pierre heard. What I heard was actually, Matt, is what you said. So rather than sitting and thinking, why is this happening to me? Why is business so difficult at the moment? I thought, why is this happening? So what opportunities is it now giving me? And that was such a fundamental mind shift. I didn't start to apply it until the next day because I needed to work my way out of that. I've actually been quite productive in kind of more business development stuff since then. And it's actually started to make a difference. So if anybody out there is listening to this thinking, well, that's all great, because that works for Matt. I can tell you that just that shift, and I'm actually a really positive person most of the time, but just that those just changing those just couple of words was so powerful. So I already want to say thank you because
You're welcome.
That made a difference to me and to kind of my outlook for the business for the future. Yeah.
I have another little saying that I can maybe I'll help you. And it's tough times will pass while tough people last. I'm gonna say it one more time. Tough times will pass while tough people last. It's, are you that tough person that's gonna outlast the tough times in your life? Because tough times are gonna pass. They're gonna come and go, but are you gonna still stick with it? Are you still gonna be there? Or are you gonna be that person that's so quickly to give up on yourself? Don't be that person. Don't be that person, because guess what? Usually the biggest breakthroughs come right after the most challenging and the most difficult moments of your life. You have to outlast them, and you have to just keep pushing forward.
That's a great saying. And actually it's really similar, and it's interesting, isn't it, how far apart we are geographically, but actually from a mindset point of view. So in the hospital I was in a hospital called Addenbrookes in Cambridge in the UK when I was poorly, and my parents would walk past it every day. There's a big slate plate in Addenbrookes in the reception area, and it's a quote by Kindersley, who was a famous Cambridge University student, and the inscription in it is whatever it is, it will pass.
Yeah.
It's just like, it's so powerful, isn't it? Whatever it is, it will pass. We will get through it, And it's going to happen with or without you. So get on board, right?
COVID right now is going to pass. All of these challenges that you're facing, whether it's your business, your relationship, your health, it will pass. As long as you are still on this earth, you have an opportunity and you have an obligation to keep pushing forward. In my opinion, I look at it this way. When I give up on myself, I'm not just giving up on myself. I'm doing a disservice to other people who need to hear what I have gone through, not even necessarily what I've gone through, but what I've learned and what I can share to the world. So anytime you're about to give up on yourself, think bigger than yourself. Stop letting that little scenario or big scenario, could be cancer or whatever it is, define you. That's the problem, is people let things define them. And then they just let it drag it on for the rest of their lives. And that's what holds them back and has all this baggage that's holding them down for their whole life.
Mm-hmm. And I think, for many people in just kind of general life, where life gets you down over time. No, I'm not a psychologist or a psychiatrist. No, I'm not going to pretend to be. But society, the amount of money you've got, your level of education, all these things can conspire against whole societies sometimes. And there is something called learned helplessness, which is a recognized psychological condition, I guess is the right word. And you can see that over time and even over generations sometimes, you can see some people, they've just kind of given up before they've even started. So, I think no matter, if you're kind of thinking, I can never do that, I can't do this because, or I can't do that, because I haven't got enough money, or I'm not from the right part of the world, or my parents didn't go to university, or nobody else in my family has run a business, or I've never run a marathon because nobody I know has run a marathon. All these things that we call I can't, or I shouldn't, or I don't think I'm allowed to. Regardless of your own experiences, all the way through to critical life-threatening situations like both you guys have had, it is a mindset thing. And so I've got a question, actually. I think I know the answer, but do you think that the majority, maybe not everybody, but the majority of people can learn to live through adversity and be really, really positive about that? Now, for some people, I guess for you guys, and Matt, you've explained that, you just get that moment It's like this moment of truth, if you like. There's something switches in your head and go, do you know what? This is not going to beat me. I'm just going to get on with it. Do you think that that's not going to come naturally to some people, but do you think some people could learn to do that? And how might they do that?
I can take it from here if you want. So first off, it didn't come naturally for me. And I'm sure it didn't come naturally for you either, Pete. It does not come naturally. It took me a good 2 years after cancer. And so I had cancer, then after cancer. So for technically for almost 3 years, I was in a very difficult part of my life. I had to really take control of my mind and my body. Like I always tell people, before you want to figure out what you're meant to do with your life or what that next step is of helping other people, you better be able to take care of yourself. And for me, it doesn't come easy, but it's practicing every single day. Remember, practice makes perfect. It's that simple saying we were taught when we were a kid, but practicing the techniques or practicing certain things in your life that is going to give you gratitude, perspective, and a sense of like, hey, whatever gets thrown my way, listen, I can't control the past and I cannot control the future, but I can control today. I can control today. So I'm going to stop worrying about the things that I can't control in my life. And I'm only going to focus on how can I learn from whatever I'm facing right now. You know, it could be a near-death experience or it could just be a regular challenge in your life. You know, people going through business right now, I think especially, are facing a lot of financial struggles with all of the things going on. But you cannot look at the past of like, what if I would have made this change? What if I would have done this in my business? What if I would have done that? Guess what it's going to do? It's going to create negative energy. And all it's going to do is it's going to create a negative future for you as well. Stop trying to focus on things you can't control. Stay present in your day and say, what today in my business can I do to push myself forward and get out of the rut that I'm in? Yeah, maybe I built myself a rut. Maybe COVID just built me a rut. I don't know what it is, but what can I do today to get me out of this? So I think anybody in the world can do it. But like you said, it has to start with the mind.
Yeah, I think Matt makes a fantastic point. And actually the point I would make is surprisingly quite similar, probably just slightly different words. So I don't know if you guys would have come across it. And the way I remember it is in an equation form. So E plus R equals O. So E is an event. And an event is something that we have no control over whatsoever. An event, getting ill, COVID, whatever it may be. And the R is responsibility. So not necessarily responsibility in the terminology of taking responsibility, but your ability to respond to that event. So your mindset, your skill set, your resilience is part of that responsibility element. And then the O, which is the outcome, equals the outcome. So the event happens and then your ability to respond can determine how positively that outcomes it creates for you. So I think part of life is sort of admitting things are going to happen, right? Things are going to happen. They're going to happen to us, for us, or what have you. And actually, we have an element of control of how we respond to that, and that will create obviously the outcomes, the opportunities, the things that will come off the back of it. And I think it's, you know, it's really empowering to see sort of how quickly you've picked up on that, Matt. You know, that actually you've responded so positively in such a short period of time as well, you know, and I think that's the thing I admire, that, you know, it took me years and years to be able to come to that. And I think, you know, I make that point to people who are listening as well, that journey may not be immediate. It may not be an immediate outcome for you that you realize that you have that power. But, you know, like for me, it was like 10, 15, potentially years. You know, and you sort of flit around and things can be quite emotional and it can be quite challenging, but actually you realize that you do have the power and the responsibility, and you can nurture that. I think it's certainly the key point. It's not something that we're born with.
No, I love that. I love E plus R equals O. So
yeah, there you go. That's one for you to use over there. Yeah,
I'm gonna write that down real quick. Really like
that. That's all right. You can take that.
Really good. I like that a lot. So,
have you come across that before, Dove?
No, it's new to me as well. I've already written it down.
good man. That's what I like to hear. Okay, cool. So, whilst we're sort of on the sort of responsibility element, we're talking, you know, we're sort of touching on resilience and that sort of thing, right? And that's something that you know, I know that Dove's very good at. He does a lot of development stuff with resilience too. So, with regards sort of specifically around business, for example, how can people, you know, people particularly in these businesses are going to be struggling with redundancies and that sort of thing. So how would you sort of apply, or your suggestion to apply that mindset that we're talking about in that situation?
Yeah. So every single time I would hit a setback, and I get it all the time in my business now. Now it's like, instead of setbacks in my health, it's setbacks in my business. So for me, what I do is I go back. I actually use my past. Like you don't use my past as a negative thing. I use my past as a lesson, like I told you. So for a lot of these people to stop getting into the same rut, stop getting into the same exact bad routine, go back and find out what was it that caused, or what was it that could have potentially caused that outcome. And you can learn from that and say, listen, I'm not going to make that mistake again. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to grow from it. And I'm going to learn from it. A lot of these people, they make the same mistakes over and over and over and over again. And what it does is that's what causes you a constant terrible routine. Routines can be good and routines can be bad, or habits can be good and habits can be bad. It's whether you take the habit as something that, you know, was maybe negative before and you turned it into a positive. That's how I look at business. Is like, if I'm not getting leads for today, what did I do? I'll look at it two different ways. If I'm not getting the leads that I should be, what did I do in the beginning that was getting me leads that I may not be doing now? Or what did I do that may have gotten me away from the leads and I need to be maybe more involved in my business again and talk to other people? So figure out what it is in the past that you've been able to kind of either say, listen, this was a good thing I can take out, or this was a thing I can learn from. And, you know, this is what I do too for all of my challenges in my life. Whenever I'm facing something really difficult and I don't know what to do next and I'm like ready to give up, I look back at a time when I was in my coma, or I had kidney and liver failure and I was in the ICU room and I couldn't even get out of my bed. And I look at myself and I say, listen, 3 years ago, I would absolutely die to be in this position right now. And yet I'm complaining about what I'm doing. And this could be somebody for anybody. You don't have to go through cancer. This could be a moment. I want you to think of a moment that was very challenging in your life that you overcame, that was way more difficult than you're going through now. And if it's not, I still want you to think of a challenge you've overcame in your life and say, listen, I'm here now. I have these opportunities. I'm still on this earth and I can still push myself forward. So that's really what's helped me. And I think what could help a lot of people in business stops, getting in that vicious cycle of like, you know, not getting the things they need in their business, like whether it's lead sales, or the right people, the right employees, whatever it is. Figure out what you've done in the past, positive and negative, and either learn from it or use it to push yourself forward.
I think that's quite key, isn't it? When I'm coaching people or talking about coaching, trying to help people to learn coaching skills, we're so focused on the future, particularly in business, just like the next quarter, the next year, you know, whatever it might be, the next cycle. So we don't spend enough time thinking about what's going on now, but also learning from the past. So you're right to have a future focus because we can dwell on the past and dwell on negativity of the past. But we don't often learn from it. And I think it's just a human trait anyway that we don't, because, you know, through history, we just look, we keep on making the same mistakes all the time. But, yeah. But it is important to learn, like I said, from the positives and the negatives and take those forward rather than repeating our own individual and in the context of business mistakes as well. Yeah, it's really important.
Yeah. And one more thing too is, I've had amazing mentors and amazing people in my life. So I think that, you know, if you have a mentor, if you have somebody you look up to in your business, stop comparing your chapter one to their chapter 20. A lot of the times, the reason why we don't go to the next level is because they're like, oh my God, look at what they're doing. And I need to do what they're doing at their chapter 20. No, go back to the person's chapter one and figure out what they did to start off, or their chapter two, or whatever you're at in their position. And what did they do to get to that next level? A lot of the times, it's a very similar pattern that will allow you to break through. So stop comparing yourself to somebody's chapter 20, your chapter one to somebody's chapter 20, and also stop trying to mimic their chapter 20 as well. Start figuring out what they did that you're in their same spot now that got them out of that rut. And that's what I think a lot of people do. They look at these successful people and they try to do all the things they're doing now, and all it does is create an insane amount of stress and overwhelm in their life.
Yeah, I think that is really true. And I see there's a video out there by Simon Sinek around resilience and millennials. I don't know if either of you have seen that, but particularly in this generation, you know, and I say that, and I'm actually part of it as well. And I know I've been guilty of it in the past as well. And you look at people who have achieved success and you think, how come they're getting that and I'm not? You know, why can't I do that? And why can't I get up tomorrow and do that stuff? And, you know, and part of it's the practice element, because you've got to practice. But you've also, you know, I think one of the things I've learned in the past sort of little while since I've been running my business is there's no shortcut. There's no shortcut at all. You've just got the hard yards. You've just got to do the hard yards, and it will take you as long as it will take you. And comparing yourself to other people is unhelpful. Mm-hmm. It's really, really unhelpful. What would you say to that, Dov?
Yeah, I think so. I think we could be careful of stereotyping millennials and putting them in a box.
I can say it because I am one, right? Yeah, I think.
I wouldn't say that. I wouldn't say that. Unless it was based on empirical research, of course. But I think, you know, I think that's probably true of every generation. You know, I'm a generation just, but only just behind Pete. And, you know, I think, you know, probably for every generation in most societies, people have gone, I wish I had some of that. And some of that is really unhelpful, but, you know, some of that can be really helpful as well, because that could be a driver for some people. But it's just, it's understanding why you want it. Is it just I want to have as good a car as my next neighbour? Is it about the kind of stuff, or is it because it's actually going to make you, I don't know, more fulfilled in some way?
Yeah. I think it's kind of, you know, I think the reason I sort of refer to millennial just to say I'm not a pig-headed bigot or anything, you know, but it's, you know, we're so much more exposed to other people's good bits, yeah? The highlights, the social media highlight reel, I suppose, is the best way of framing that. And it's so easy to see all the good bits from other people and that they're not facing the challenges that we're talking about or the adversity that we're talking about. And just because it's not present online doesn't mean that it's not there. You know, it's really important that we have our eye on reality and where that is.
That right there is super powerful. You do not always, what you see on Instagram and Facebook and LinkedIn and all and YouTube is not what they're going through every single day. You are seeing highlights of 99% of the people, and the people who are willing to be vulnerable and share their story, that is what everybody else is going through. Most of the time you see these flashy cars and all this stuff, half of them is not even theirs. They're just flaunting it to make themselves look better. And I love what you guys were saying too about, like, listen, it's okay to use them as motivation. I love using, you know, where people are at as motivation, but I don't use it as a comparison tool. I don't say, wow, this kid's 22 years old, I'm 28, and he's got all this money and he's, you know, he has a successful business right now. And it's like, listen, he might've started before me. He might had the right opportunity, but you know what, if anything, I'm just going to learn from him instead of being this victim of, like, you know, why is he so far ahead of me? I think that's the biggest thing is, as millennials, we compare ourselves not to necessarily the older crowd. We compare ourselves to our peers. We compare ourselves to the people that are close to our age because we're like, wow, I'm 28, he's 27, and look where he's at, and I'm not there. Why am I not there? And then we fall into this, like, trap of, like, comparing and wanting to be that person, and it gets you nowhere. You're absolutely correct. I love what you guys are saying about that.
It can be, you know, it, not even just about business, you know, it can be a career thing as well and a positional thing. And, you know, even down to, like, title envy. You know, people get title envy in the corporate world as well. You know, he's made director. He's been made director, and I'm a manager. How come he's been made director? Go on, Duff. Where you go?
It's just a word, isn't it? Yeah, and
exactly.
I've worked in, like, you know, I've worked in corporates. I know lots of people, like all of us, that work in corporates. And actually, do you know what? It's just a title, because the director in one business can be something very, very different. You know, I was talking to somebody the other day. Like a head of learning and development in the UK can have a salary range. You know, the difference can be about £60,000 a year for the same job title. You know, it's really not about the title. It's about who you show up as every day, the value that you add. You know, to yourself and your family, the people closest to you. You know, to your employer or your customers. We do live in a very we live in a world where actually the glitter really seems to matter, and do you know what, it really really doesn't. You know, and those kind of things, you know, psychologically, they will motivate people. Title and prestige and those, they are drivers for some people, but they're not for everybody. And if they're not for you, I guess, just get off that wheel and just be a bit more honest with yourself.
It's interesting. That's just made me think of a quote. Is it, try not to be a man of power, try to be a man of substance. I'm sure there's a saying. But substance is so true, right? Because it's not about the title, it's not about the car or the bling or whatever it may be in reality. And actually that kind of rounds quite nicely to the adversity that we face, because actually the real measure is the measure of our ability to be able to respond to stuff, not necessarily the materialistic things that we gather around us.
Yeah. And for me, what I found is, like you were saying, the title doesn't necessarily matter. You can be the greatest leader and actually lead people who are underneath. You can lead other people. Just because they have that title doesn't mean you can't be a better leader and a better person. And it doesn't mean that you can't eventually get above and where they're at and above to where they are. You know, you just have to, you know, continuously be who you are as that leader, you know, for the people who need to hear you and the people who need to listen to you. And I think that's what's going to push you forward as a successful individual, is learning how to become a leader. And the best thing is lead by example. Leaders are not people who tell people what to do. Leaders are people who dive in and go right into the deep, dirty, you know, sorry shit that people are facing themselves, you know? Like, you know, if you want to be this successful person, do what the people underneath you, or, you know, the people who look up to you are doing, because that's how they're going to relate to you. And that's how they're going to see you as somebody who they can look up to as well. You don't have to have this title. All you need to do is take the correct action and have the right mindset to help these people while, you know, go pretend being like somebody that they can relate to. You're not better than they are. You're even in the sense of like, hey, listen, I'm no greater than you. You're no greater than me. We're together in this. It's just, I'm showing you the way. That's all. And I think that's what creates an amazing leader. And it gets out of that title mentality.
We talked for a little while about, you know, because you are a motivational speaker, and you do talk to everybody from CEOs at the top of the corporate food chain, if you like, all the way through to different parts of society. And I know that you've gone back into the hospitals, but you know, you're going to schools and colleges and things like that. How do the messages differ for those kind of populations? But also what I'm interested in, I guess, is what's similar, what's common with all
the things? I'll start with what's different. So what's different is you have a different audience. So you go to a college, you're talking to younger adults. So a lot of the time I'm not necessarily just talking about business or anything like that. I'm talking about what's their next step in their life. You know, after college, you know, a lot of them are, the biggest thing that they don't understand is the importance of being patient with themselves and realizing that when they come out of college, they're not just going to have their life dream all set up for them. Like, I need to share with them, listen, you're going to go through the, after college is when you go through all the real shit in life. And that's what's going to be your defining moment. So if I'm talking to colleges or high schools or things like that, I'm talking more about their future and what they can build and saying, hey, listen, you have an amazing purpose and don't be afraid to go after it. You know, if you spent the next 8 years of your life just going for your purpose, guess what? You haven't lost anything. All you've done is gained experience, and you can go back to whatever job you wanted to have, you know? So that's what I explained to the colleges. If I go to hospitals, I talk about people who are, you know, going through the medical journey. So I'll help them with whatever, you know, challenges they're facing mentally and physically. And then on this podcast, we're talking about business. So it's all about the audience and the community. And the similar thing, though, is like we've always been saying, we're all going to go through adversity, but it's how can you be resilient and how can you, you know, be that leader and be the person that people will look up to, you know, by creating the best version of yourself and using your lessons in whatever you go through in life to help other people. So, you know, that's kind of what's helped me. And I've learned that throughout really the year of me speaking. So.
Nice. Okay. So with regards to certainly particularly people who are listening, that two things may be happening. and they may be struggling in their business, or they may be looking at being made redundant, for example, and then having to job hunt in a difficult marketplace. What sort of key actions, we'll start with sort of the actions that we could take or people could take, just have a bit of a talk through those, and then we'll look at maybe some top tips for sort of dealing with sort of where, because that by taking those actions, if it's not successful, it's going to challenge the mindset. So then we need to think about keeping that on track too, right?
Yeah. So what action? So you're asking me, sorry, you froze for like 2 seconds. So I just wanted to clarify this.
Apologies.
It's not your fault. So, you know, what actions can they take in their business to kind of push themselves forward?
Yeah. So with the adversity people are facing with Corona, like COVID and the impact that's had with lockdown. So obviously some people are going to be hunting for new jobs, and that's going to be quite challenging, for example, right? So what sort of actions would you say that they should take to be able to protect themselves and sort of look after themselves during that time?
Yeah, absolutely. I think now's a good time to actually step back and figure out, what are you passionate about? Like, what are you really passionate about? Because a lot of these people in their jobs, they're starting to realize, I never even liked my job. I got laid off and I didn't even freaking like it. So what are you passionate about? What do you love? And what can you take action on today that can get you to a job or a career or a business that you'd like to start? So I think that's the biggest actionable step you can take, is figuring out, what am I passionate about? You know, it's not necessarily your purpose. Everyone thinks that they need to find their purpose from, you know, oh, I have my passion, now I know what my purpose is. That's not necessarily the truth. You need to take actionable steps to find your purpose. But what are you passionate about? Are you passionate about helping other people? Are you passionate about art? Are you passionate about sports? Are you passionate about, what is it that you love to do every day that is like a hobby to you that you can turn into a career? Almost any hobby that you have, you can somehow turn it into a career. It might not be the exact route that you want to go. You might not be a football player. You know, you might not be a baseball player or a basketball player, but you could get into that field. Or you might not, you know, you might not be the next Van Gogh, but like, you could get into an artist, you know, job where you're helping other people and teaching them. So, you know, my point is what are you passionate about, and how can you make a career, or can you find a job doing that? Because right now, people are not looking for money. I'm telling you right now, COVID, people are not looking for money. They're looking for happiness. We're all looking for happiness. We're not looking for that next money so that we can pay for our bills. We're looking for happiness, which will equate to the money, which will equate to, you know, figuring everything out. But you got to figure out what you're passionate about, and that's what's going to create the happiness. And I think that's the best actionable step I could give somebody to take in their job or their business.
Yeah, that sounds fair enough. And then when obviously people are going to go hunting and they're going to obviously face some setbacks and what have you. So what advice would you give for a tip on, like, when things are sort of quite tough and they're just like, oh, why is everything going against me? And that, you know, because it's natural, isn't it, that victim mindset might sort of draw in a little bit. What do you think can we plant as maybe like a trigger for people to go, I'm having a victim mindset, I need to change that?
Yeah. Okay. I want to share a little bit of my story first, so that's going to kind of lead into it. So, you know, we're going to go past the chemo and when I was going through my really difficult time. So, you know, after my chemo, I had my surgery to remove my tumor, to remove the rest of my cancer. And that's where it caused a lot of complications. I had a 12-hour surgery, and I ended up having massive swelling in my stomach. And 2 weeks later, they ended up rushing me back to the emergency room, where they drained 7 liters of fluid out of my stomach. And that's what caused me to go into kidney and liver failure. I had a cone drilled in my head to relieve brain swelling. And that's where I fell into my 2-week coma. And throughout the ICU, I was in the ICU for 40 days. I was in the Cleveland Clinic, you know, emergency room for 53 days. So, you know, throughout that period of time, I had 5 surgeries, like I explained to you. And on that 5th surgery, I had what was called an open wound surgery on my stomach. So I had stitches from my left hip to my right hip. And what had happened was on my 4th surgery, they must have done something a little off. And about a week and a half later, my stitches popped open. I don't want to get too gruesome, but my stitches popped open. My spleen was sticking out of my stomach. My spleen was sticking out of my stomach right when I thought that I was almost ready to leave. Like, I was like, okay, here's the breakthrough I needed to go home. And a massive setback hit me again. And I had to go back into that 5th major surgery, and they had to do what's called an open wound surgery on me. So they couldn't close my skin back together. So I had to leave a football sized mesh on my stomach to hold everything together. I ended up back in the ICU that day. And this time was really scary because when I woke up from my coma, I was so out of it. I didn't know what was going on, but this time I knew where I was. I had my hands strapped to the bed. I had my feet strapped to the bed and I couldn't move. I had a breathing tube in my mouth, so I couldn't even talk to get these nurses. So for 2 days, I was sitting there and all I could think of was, listen, I am in rock bottom of my life. I'm in rock bottom of my life. And this is how I want to equate to somebody who's like setback after setback after setback. I'm trying to get that job. I'm trying to figure out what I want to do with my life. And what I told myself was, listen, Matt, I have two options. I can give up on myself, or I am in the lowest part of my life, and the only place I can do is go up from here. And what I did was, when they released me, I got up and I charged forward. Literally, I walked further than I ever did, you know, previous to the ICU room, previous to any of the other times. And I was out of the ICU in like 4 days, making leaps and bounds. But the thing that changed was my mindset of saying, listen, I am in a rock bottom situation of my life. And that was with my health. And the only place I can go is up. So I have to take a massive actionable step to get myself out of there. And for me, it was getting up and just walking as far as I could without, you know, hesitating. And I think for business, how I can relate to that is somebody who constantly is saying, no, we're not going to accept this job. No, you know, you have this business you're running and you're just not getting anything in, or you're losing all of these, you know, all of these clients and things like that. The one thing you can say to yourself is, listen, I may be in rock bottom right now, but what is one massive action I can take today? I don't know what that massive action is. I mean, I wish I could tell you. You know, I've only been in business for a year. So all I can ask you is what is that one big step today that can push you forward? A lot of the times, the reason we're in a plateau is, you know, we should be doing little things, but one thing that can actually get you out of a plateau is taking like a huge like step forward, like in a 24-hour period or 48-hour period. So for me, let me think of an example for business that would like equate to a really big push forward for like 24 to 48 hours. It would be like, I don't even know, like reaching, instead of like saying, you know, I'm done reaching out to people, instead of reaching out to only 5 people, you reach out to like 40 people that day. Like you just do something that's like, listen, I didn't even know I could do, but I'm going to just take that imperfect action. So I'm not going to try and be perfect. I'm going to take that imperfect action and I'm just going to just give myself out, because guess what? I have absolutely nothing to lose at this point. I'm financially broken. I can't find a job. I don't know what my business is doing. So I need to take something imperfect. I can't worry what other people are going to think of me. I can't worry about the judgment, and I'm just going to go for it. It might just be making a ton of phone calls. It might just be putting yourself out there and doing something that like is so scary to you, but is going to make a world of difference. I don't know what that is because I'm just so young in business, but what I've heard from the most successful entrepreneurs is doing that massive action in a 48 to 24 hour window of something that you never thought you could do, but you just go in and take imperfect action on it.
Yeah. No, that sounds, it sounds like a fair suggestion, to be fair. And with regards, one of the challenges that I think people can get held back by, obviously with something like that, where you go, you know, I'm going to take massive action. I'm going to make this huge step. And you've got to have the confidence to be able to do that. I think one of the things that will hold people back is that fear of rejection.
Yeah.
So, you know, have you sort of been through an experience where you've felt that rejection before, and how have you overcome that?
All the time. You know, the biggest rejections that I had was actually my friends and family not believing in me. And some of them still don't, but don't believing in me when I told them I wanted to help change the world with, you know, my story as a speaker, as a coach, and all these amazing things. Even my parents at the time were, they're never not supportive, but they were like, I don't like Matt. They kept questioning me and having all these negative doubts. And my friends, every time I'd post on social media, some of them think they're cool because like I'm in a friends group, and you know, they're like, oh, why is Matt like trying to be bigger than us and cooler than us? And I'm like, this has nothing to do with you guys. And that really hit me hard of like, I was worried about the judgment. I was worried about what my friends and family were thinking of me. And the second I eliminated that shit from my life and said, listen, they're going to be the biggest critics now, and they're going to be my biggest fans in 5-10 years. So guess what? Screw them. I don't mean screw them as like my family and friends, like I'm never going to talk to them. I just mean, I have to eliminate. This is a big thing. I have to eliminate certain people in my life and I have to gain new friends in order to get to where I want to be. Your net, this is another thing to get you out of your rut. Your net worth or your network is your net worth. So the people you hang around with, your environment is vital to getting you out of your rut. It's vital to getting you to that next step. And what I did is I gained new friends that were in the same direction as me, looking to, you know, better themselves, looking to grow in the, you know, their jobs and their life and their health. And I'm telling you, when you're around that environment, when you're around those people, it's like you're just on a one-way mission with them to, you know, to success. And yes, there's going to be ups and downs, but when you have those downs, you're going to have those people there to support you. You're going to have those people there to help you get out of that rut. Instead of saying, I'm going to go back to my old friends where it's like, oh, come back down. Let's be comfortable and talk about our high school glory days. Like that's a classic thing that your old friends will do is always talk about the football days or, you know, oh, look at what I did and how cool I was when I was 18 years old. I don't do that anymore. I get that out of my life. And I say, how am I going to have a brighter future and be with the people who I need to get me there? That's the key.
I was just thinking about how I can relate to this, because obviously, like I said earlier, I can't relate to the experiences that you guys have gone. I think I might have mentioned on previous podcasts that gardening is one of my passions. Yeah, it's just that I'm not an excellent gardener, but I love it. And sometimes I'll buy a plant, and it might be like, I don't know, £7-8, like $10 or whatever. And you put it in the garden, and it starts to fail. And there's a phrase in gardening, it's the right plant in the right place. So what you're going to do sometimes, you're just going to go, in my mind, I thought, that's why I want that plant, because I've seen it, and I've got a plant there. But that plant's just going to, well, it's going to die. But if you just move it somewhere else, you know, different soil or different level of light or shade or whatever it might be, then all of a sudden it flourishes. Yeah, so it's actually, that story is nowhere near as powerful as what you just said. But I suppose, you know, from my reality, you know, thinking that that's how I can relate to that. But it's true for people as well, isn't it? It's like the right person in the right culture, if you like, because plants grow in cultures and people are like that as well. You can be around the mood hoovers in your life, you know, the people that suck the life out of you, or you could be around the people who are like radiators, if you like, who will just give you energy and you just thrive off each other's energy and enthusiasm. You
know? I thought that was quite ancient Greek philosophical, actually, about the plant. It's it's saying about it's the environment, isn't it? You know, we've got to have the right environment to grow.
100%. And I think I wouldn't be here, and Pete, you could probably say the same thing. I would not be where I'm at today without the support I've had. You know, when I was going through cancer, without Lauren, like, I'm going to tell a really cool story about Lauren here in a second, but your support in your most difficult times is everything. Like, you know, for me, I would not have gotten through cancer and my chemo and all that without my amazing people in my life. And the thing was they were there for me when I was going through cancer, but as soon as I started to do something bigger with my life, and I don't mean this in a negative way, but some of them, I still have amazing friends who support me no matter what, like that have been there for me, and I love them to death. And this is not like a negative thing, but some of them, they just don't understand it, and they couldn't support me because I was doing something bigger than maybe they could see themselves doing. So, but what my point is like, throughout, you know, cancer, and I'm sure you can relate to this, is you wouldn't get through those difficult times without having those people there by your side. And, you know, that's a vital, vital part in overcoming whatever adversity you're going through in your life. If you try to fight these battles alone, not only is it going to be an extremely lonely battle, but it's going to be almost an impossible battle to overcome as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I can't believe how quickly the time has flown.
Podcast, I think it's the quickest hour of the week.
It is, absolutely. And do you know what? It's particularly flown because we've got to listen to Matt's awesome stories as well, which have been absolutely incredible, mate. So I really appreciate you sharing them and actually having the strength. You know, you should be really, you know, having the strength that you've got to be able to come out and go, do you know what? This is who I am and this is what has happened to me. And I'm okay with that. And I'm okay with pushing myself out there and talking about it. Like, real kudos for that, right? Because, you know, I personally obviously have had things happen, but for me to have the strength of character to turn out and go, I'm going to be a motivational speaker, I'm going to go and do this, and I'm going to say that about myself, you know, huge kudos for you for doing that, you know. So I really appreciate you you joining us today. Dove, what have you let's do it, shall we? What have you learned this week, or am I putting you on the spot?
Just a little bit. So I'm still absorbing all the information.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So, Matt, what we normally do when we tie up the podcast is we do like a quick, like, quick fire, like, what have we learned this week? So I'm going to let Dove have a little reflect. And I'm just going to put out there now that, do you know what? It's so important to take responsibility. So that's my big thing, is that when I said earlier about the responsibility, it's not so much that, but taking like sort of self responsibility that, do you know what, like we have so much power to impact what happens around us, and stuff is going to happen, and just being able to accept that, but realizing that, you know, we have the choice when something happens, we have the choice to either take responsibility or to be a victim. And actually, you know, bad things are going to happen. You know, sadly, you know, the biggest equalizer for all of us is death in one way or another. And we have a choice in how we embrace that into our lives and move forward. So that's my key takeaway for on a Friday for the weekend, right? So, Dove, I've given you a little bit of breathing space. Over to you.
It was just enough time. It relates to what you're saying, actually. But I was offered some help this week. And I'm quite a proud person. I think most people in business are quite proud of what they've achieved and what they want to achieve. But I was offered some help this week and I took it. I thought, you know what, I can keep on doing what I'm doing, but that isn't quite working the way that I want it. And I was offered some help and I took it. And already within a couple of days, it's making a difference. So I think what I've learned is, or reminded myself, is that don't be too proud to get help. Surround yourself, going back to what Mike was saying earlier, surround yourself with the right people so you're in that place where you can grow. And then accept the help when it's offered, because it can really make a difference. Because most of us are there because we want to help each other. You know, Matt's aim in life, and I've written it down, is I want to help change the world. That's one hell of an aspiration. It really is. But why not? Why go for anything
else? But that bravery to even say those words, right? I've just got total admiration for that. So Matt, do you know what? I'm going to put you on the spot too. We don't normally do this with the guests, but do you know what? I think you've like handled every question that's come your way really, really well today. So tell me, what's your big key takeaway for today? Big top tip.
Yeah, my biggest key takeaway. Oh gosh. Yeah, I love it. You put me on the spot.
This is good.
For me, you know, I loved how we talked about, you know, using kind of what you were saying, E plus R equals O. So using our past. Oh yeah, I love it. I had to bring using our past, you know, is something that's not going to, something we can't control. Like we can't control those events that have happened in the past. What we can do is we can take responsibility, and we can also become a better person by learning from the things that we couldn't change, and also using the things that were successful in our life to push ourselves forward and allowing us to create the opportunities to, you know, help the people that are in need, and to grow in our life, grow in our business, grow in our relationship, grow in our health, grow in our personal development, grow in our faith, grow in everything in our life. You know, I really love this podcast because, you know, I know what, this is the very first podcast where I actually never got to share my full story. And I actually love it because we went into so much detail on other things that, like, this was a true podcast of just explaining how to overcome whatever situation, especially with COVID going on, and to help you grow your business or whatever area of life that you may be struggling in. So I appreciate you guys having me on. And it was a true, you know, honestly, like, honor to be on the podcast. So I appreciate it.
Well, it's an honor to have had you guest. It really has. And, you know, hopefully listeners have had the outcomes that we'd hoped from this session, which was around facing adversity and having taken that choice whether to wallow or to whether take action and take responsibility. So hopefully people have taken that. So, yeah, thank you, everyone, for listening. And we look forward to joining you again next week. Cheers. Bye-bye.
Bye, guys.
Thank you for joining us on the Stronger for Business podcast. A final thought before we go. In the words of Henry Ford, anyone who stops learning is old, whether at 20 or 80. Anyone who keeps learning stays young. So stay young and join us next Friday for our next episode of the Stronger for Business podcast.